Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. Pam Gosell is joining us remotely today and we've received apologies from Gordon MacDonald. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thanks. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on rural and island housing from Stuart Black, who's the Chief Executive at the Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Professor Russell Griggs, who's the Chair of the South of Scotland Enterprise, Ronnie McRae, who's Chief Executive Officer at Communities Housing Trust, Ilsa Rayburn, who is the Chair at Community Land Scotland, Pauline Smith, who's the Chief Executive at Development Trust Association Scotland, and Mike Staples, who's the Chief Executive at South of Scotland Community Housing. And I warmly welcome all of our witnesses to the meeting. And we have a number of questions today. There's no need for you to turn on your microphones. We'll do that for you. And I'm going to begin by asking a kind of broad question just to kind of set the scene, and then we can get into detail. So the kind of my question is really around kind of highlighting the challenges that we face around placemaking and housing across rural Scotland. And so basically that's what I'd be interested in hearing from each of you. If you feel like the points have been covered, you don't need to come in on that, but there's certainly going to be time throughout the morning to come in. So it's basically if you could provide a brief overview of the role of your organisation so we understand who we're hearing from, the area it covers, and what you consider are the main housing challenges. And maybe I will just go with the order of folks that I, the way I introduced you. So let's start with Stuart and then we'll go to Russell.
Yes, good morning, Matinva. Housing is obviously a very significant issue for the Highlands and Islands. We have a growing economy in many places and housing is acting as something of a constraint on economic growth. Highlands and Islands Enterprise supports communities and businesses to grow and sustain and make successful the region that we are based in. Our aim as an agency is to become a leading net zero region, and for that to happen we need to have a successful economy and we need housing that will help support that economy. In many parts of our region, housing is a barrier to economic growth and the lack of housing is constraining businesses from expanding. The main issues are around housing is generally provided to tackle homelessness rather than to support the economy. And in our region, often in rural areas, people don't present as homeless because they don't think there's housing available. So homelessness tends to present in urban areas rather than in rural areas. And indeed, many of the affordable homes which are provided are in urban areas compared to rural areas, which pulls people into the centre, pulls many young people into centres of population rather than able to stay in rural locations. Recently, we had a board meeting in Harris, and the businesses there in the next 5 years said that they could take on an extra 200 people, but there simply isn't the housing for them. Harris has a population of 2,000, and it's an area where the population has been falling. So we have the irony that in the past it was jobs that were lacking and people left. Now we have jobs available and insufficient housing to accommodate the people who want to come. So I think in a nutshell that's our challenge. We need more housing for economic purposes to support and sustain populations and reverse some of our population decline. Okay. Thanks.
Great. Thanks very much for that. Can I bring in Russell and then followed by Ronnie?
Thank you, Gambina. I'm here not just on behalf of South of Scotland Enterprise this morning, but on behalf of the South of Scotland Regional Economic Partnership. We see housing as one of the key challenges, and the partnership is both councils, both NHS boards, both the colleges, the academic institutes, and everybody else there. And last year, at the Convention of the South of Scotland, we declared housing as one of our key challenges. And I've been asked many times, am I concerned about housing in the South of Scotland? And I'm not. I'm terrified. Because we have communities, and you've got to remember, we only have 4 communities that have more than 10,000 population in the south of Scotland. So we have a lot of tiny little communities, and when the private house builders came down to the convention, they said that they're not interested in building anything under 100 units, maybe 50 on a good day, and that would only then apply to a very small number of our communities. So our issues are very similar to Stuart's, in that as we grow the economy, it's where we put the people that we will bring into the region to run the businesses and to be part of those businesses. But I also like to say that rural Scotland is not a cohesive mass. That's a thing we all need to get our head around. It's not all the same, it's different. And we need to recognise those differences regionally as we do this. So both my councils aren't involved in housing really at all. We have seven local registered social landlords who look after all our affordable and social housing in the south of Scotland, and they've got very different issues of where they want to go and how we would bring them forward. So similar to Stuart, it is about if we want to grow the economy in the south of Scotland, but more importantly, keep our young people in the south of Scotland, we have to have somewhere for them to live. And that's a big challenge, especially as we look at things like the growth of second homes, which now, for example, account for 30% of the housing stock in Gatehouse of Fleet and other parts of where we just don't have the places for these young people to go.
Okay, thanks very much. Ronnie and then Ailsa.
Thank you, Convener. Communities Housing Trust operates north of the Central Belt. Our role is to support communities, specifically on placemaking, and a lot of our projects will demonstrate that. The challenges we're finding at the moment, over the last 2 or 3 years, we've got positive policy and action plans from Scottish Government. Unfortunately, they're not working because they're seen in isolation. And until they can be joined together, we're going to struggle to make any progress. The need and demand from communities, service providers and businesses, as we've heard, is growing. But delivery of affordable housing, all housing, not just affordable housing, is slowing, severely slowing, predominantly because of high costs. Our feeling is clear that that's because of a lack of labour. And again, going back to policy and action plans, you know, we've got the depopulation, repopulation issues, we've got community wealth building, community empowerment, and there's massive opportunities to grow rural construction sectors. It needs to be done through different procurement routes. It needs more flexibility from Scottish Government and the Rural and Island Housing Fund. And we need to expand the range of tenures and finance models that can be used. Most of them, there's a lot out there that have been done already. We should be using more of that. But the crux for the smaller communities that we work in is making sure we repopulate and regenerate the rural construction sector.
Thanks. Ailsa and then Pauline.
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation to speak today. I'm Chair of Community Land Scotland, so we're the membership organisation for community landowners across all of Scotland, and I'm also Chair of the Isle of Egg Heritage Trust, which is a really successful community but struggling on a day-to-day basis with housing. So the key issue for communities that we represent, and Egg as well, is that we know that young people want to stay in those communities. They want to return to them when they've gone away for education, and we know that people want to come and live in our communities. So there's a huge demand, and coming back to the point that Stuart made, we know that there is demand, we know that there are jobs, and we know that we can address the depopulation and demographic challenges that rural areas are facing, but that all hinges upon having the right housing in the right place. And partly it is affordable housing, it is social housing, but it's also housing of all tenure types. So we know that people that want to come and live in our communities want to buy their own house, and they might want to build their own house, and they want the sorts of opportunities that people have in other areas around housing. So that's really important. We know that a lack of housing means that communities suffer from loss of services and loss of key businesses. So again, coming back to the linking housing and employment and the economy is really important. The impact of second homes and short-term lets has already been mentioned, and it's really good to see that there's now focus on that as an issue in our housing stock, but more needs to be done. Many communities are leading with the support of organisations like Ronnie's and Mike in the south of Scotland on delivering housing at a small scale, because there is complete failure in the private sector and largely in the public sector housing provision in small rural communities. The only people that are active are community trusts. And we know they're not active because they really want to get involved in housing. They're not housing experts. They're doing it because they're very outcomes focused about trying to ensure their communities can grow and thrive. And really, that's one of the big calls from us today, is that all of the partners in the provision of housing supply need to be outcomes focused. So what are we trying to achieve by delivering more housing, whether that's public housing or private housing? And that is around depopulation, addressing demographic challenge, allowing the economy to grow, ensuring that we don't lose key services, etc. And at the moment, a lot of the policy focus on housing is very narrow in terms of, it's like, how many units can you deliver? And obviously it's much cheaper to deliver 100 units in Stornoway than it is 10 lots of 10 units across the west of the Western Isles. So we need a change in thinking about what housing does, what housing can be, and how it can support thriving and sustainable communities. And say, to do that, we need to think much more about the outcomes of housing development rather than be narrowly focused on unit numbers. Thank you. Thank you, Katrina.
Pauline and then Mike.
Hi, I'm Pauline Smith. Detach represents about 350 development trusts right across Scotland. And I think just building on what Yulsa says, that the development trusts that are involved in housing didn't really get into it by choice. They've been set up because of issues within their neighbourhoods that they want to overcome. And housing, I don't think, you know, years ago we would have thought they were going to get into housing, but because of the failures now, they have to step in and get involved and take it forward, because many of our members have sort of said to me that they could create hundreds of jobs, as well as the businesses, but even community trusts, they could. But there's nowhere for anyone to live. There's a massive problem with allocation processes, which is again why development trusts have got involved in this. So the elderly resident has to move out of the area quite often, and they can't stay there. Young people can't move in because there's no single occupancy. So I walked through one of the villages last week actually, and every single home apart from two in the whole of the main street was second homes. Only two remained within the main street for people who lived there, which is just really sad. I think that a bit like Ailsa said about the planning side of things, you know, some of these are really small scale on three houses, but also the bigger ones at high. I've mentioned about 100 houses, but the planning processes and various things at the moment don't seem to be going along with what communities are doing. So the powers, the legislation, the access to these, the funding and the finances don't seem to be moving with where communities actually are responsible for these days. And I think we have to look at that empowerment side of things, of saying this is empowering you by, you know, you're running the houses, you're building the houses, you're running the shop, etc. The powers and finances need to go alongside that to actually make and emphasise and make it easier for these communities to do it. And I think we'll probably come on to that when we talk about the housing funds, etc. So, yeah.
Thanks, Mike.
Hey, thank you, convener. South of Scotland Community Housing, we're the community-led housing enabler working across southern Scotland, so Central Belt South. Working in partnership with Communities Housing Trust to provide that support across all of the country. Our focus is on working with community organisations to provide that life cycle support, to help understand those local needs, and to have a focus on the holistic view around the contribution that housing makes to place and regeneration. Just to reiterate some of Russell's points, we are experiencing extreme housing pressure in the rural communities in the south of Scotland, and many of the issues that we face now have been recently exacerbated and are very similar to the issues faced in the Highlands and Islands. In amongst that, from our perspective, we have seen a significant increase in demand for our services. Many, many communities are wanting to tackle this issue. We're building between us a significant pipeline of potential new projects, but we're finding an imbalance between that and deliverability at this point in time. And as Ronnie said, that's very acutely driven by development costs, construction market, construction skills, but there's a huge amount of opportunity in amongst all of that. And at the moment, the process, as Ronnie said, very strong policy framework, Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan, the Rural and Islands Housing Fund, but then the deliverability is a significant challenge right now.
Okay, great. Thanks very much for that. I think that's been really a helpful starting place. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs, who has a number of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for your initial thoughts. Collaboration between partner organisations and community engagement is key to building rural homes, and I think that's what you've all touched upon. And could I ask you, therefore, in terms of local authorities, how are they supporting that community-led development of houses, and especially for large rural councils, which many of you will be working with? I don't know if anyone wants to come in. Yeah.
Well, I can start, but I know that Ronnie and Mike will have regular contacts with local authorities as well. And I think they're now starting to recognise the role of partnership in a way that perhaps they haven't done until recently, because there's a recognition that actually we do all need to work together, that you need all of the players here. So we've got the regional economic partnerships, obviously Stuart and Russell have talked about. So there's an agency level. What can they do to unlock some of the issues? Local authorities obviously have access to SHIP funds, but also the second home council tax, which some of and now starting to reinvest back into the provision of affordable homes. So that's really helpful. So I would say from a community's perspective, from the funding side and the policy side, they're trying to be as helpful as they can. There is still the planning issues, which Mike's already raised and perhaps worthy of a separate discussion. But they don't have access to huge amounts of funds. Obviously, the most of the funding that comes for community-led development is via Scottish Government, and that's where we need a bit more collaboration. But I'll let colleagues speak more detail. Sure.
Ronnie.
I think, as I said at the beginning, that very much our housing challenges are a joint challenge between us all, between the two councils. The two councils are working very close with us on doing this. The planning issues that have been raised are, and I think Fiona, the chief planner, put it, we need all our planners to become enablers, not disablers, if we could put that in a simple word. And I think that is where we need to get to with a lot of them. But we're seeing now a joint recognition of what the big problems are. The whole issue around second homes, and we need to have a different discussion to at another time. And in terms of funding, one of the interesting things, we don't think it's a funding issue in the south of Scotland. There are issues with some of the funds that we need to talk about, nor do we think it's a land issue. We've got plenty of land. It's about getting the communities together, which comes back to the point that the convener made at the beginning, is our view is that where the local authorities in the south of Scotland, in our opinion, are doing a very good job, is in place planning. It is out in every community putting together really good place plans that do include housing. So they're not just asking the community to ask, what would you like to see in 5 or 10 years? They're actually saying, what infrastructure do you need to know that? You know, what houses do you know, what type of houses? So, and the point that's been made, this isn't just about affordable houses. We need houses for doctors, for teachers, for all sorts of people that come into the area. The health board in Dumfries and Galloway has an accommodation shortage at the moment of 160 homes for its staff. One of the universities has stopped bringing master students in because it's difficult to house them. So in my view, the local authorities have stepped up to the plate, more to do in terms of planning, but there are some big issues out there that we need to deal with.
Yeah, thank you. In general, we work with a number of different local authorities, and they are supportive and helpful. I think we have the Rural and Island Housing Fund, which is guidance clearly sets out that it's to provide housing that assists communities. I think there's a bit of confusion there. There can be, and not just in local authorities, but across Scottish Government. The lines are blurred between the mainstream housing, which is there with a very strong, quite rightly, focus on homelessness, but the Rural and Island Housing Fund is very much about community and placemaking. Mixing the two has caused problems, and I think we need a clearer definition and understanding of the two different funds, because the irony is If they can both work as they are intended to, we will deliver bigger impacts on homelessness and on community wealth building and empowerment. So I think there's a bit of work there. One of the things we think should be considered is for the Rural and Island Housing Fund to potentially have a rural-focused governance board made up of communities, service providers and businesses to sharpen the focus for the Rural and Island Housing Fund and make sure that the lines are not blurred, because area teams in Scottish Government can get confused on what sort of housing they're trying to deliver, and we're missing opportunities to partner.
Just on that, Bonnie, the confusion bit, could you just say a bit more about what actually happens on the ground then, or is it that it slows things down, that confusion? Just say a little bit more about the two different pieces kind of coming up against each other.
Yeah, I mean, we see an occasion where, partnerships are not encouraged because, a lot of our developments have included social housing providers, housing associations or the council, business housing, community-led housing. And the feeling more recently is that we're going away from that, and there's more of a focus on the homelessness element. And we're forgetting about the community empowerment and community wealth building elements and the benefits that can bring. I think we're missing an awful lot of opportunities, especially to work with businesses and use finance opportunities. We could be doing an awful lot more with a bit more flexibility and stronger understanding.
Okay, thanks. Mike?
I think around the issue of local authority support, particularly to community-led housing, the attitude and enabling approach from local authority is vital. I think just to reiterate the point that it needs to be applied consistently. Our experience in support of what Russell says is that Dumfries and Galloway and Scottish Borders are extremely supportive and proactive around community-led housing, but we need to see that approach, particularly to supporting the Rural Housing Fund and supporting communities, mirrored elsewhere. Ilse mentioned the use of council tax fund. Just to give a quick shout-out from our perspective to Dumfries and Galloway Council, their use of income from council tax on second homes as a ring-fenced fund that communities can access has been vital to enabling a whole range of community-led projects where there's been a gap in the funding. So we see that as really great best practice around a local authority attitude to this sector.
Okay. I had a follow-up question, but I'm going to bring in Stuart first.
Yes, thanks very much, Convener. So Highlands and Islands Enterprise, we're half the landmass of Scotland, 51% of the landmass from Shetland down to the Mull of Kintyre. We've got seven councils that we work with. I think in terms of good practice, Orkney is really good at this. They have a lot of development trusts on their outer islands, some of which have got their own wind energy, which then provides a source of income. And I think revenue for communities is really fundamental. And in the case of Orkney, the council is working very closely with the local development trust to create more housing, particularly on the outer islands of Orkney. And they're talking about potentially providing some finance as well. So that's good practice. I think for every community group, the challenge is that often their housing project that they're involved in is the first one. So it really does depend on who they get to speak to at the council, how they build relationships. And often they do one project and then that's it, because it's taken them anything up to 10 years to get a project done. Usually they're pretty tired. So it tends to be that councils will work quite well with different communities, but the communities find the process very, very slow. And I think that causes frustration, and some of that can be reflected in relationships. But there are good examples, and right across the patch in our area, communities are working with councils and working with other partners. We have a regional economic partnership group focused on housing because it's such an important issue for us. So there is good collaboration, but I think in terms of for each community on the ground, the experience is probably different depending on where they are. I think that's a point that has been made about more consistency. Thanks.
Thanks for that. It's been a year now since the Scottish Government established a £25 million key workers fund for rural island communities. Now, that hasn't delivered one single home, the last set of data I asked government for. So can you outline the role rural housing enablers are playing in that? And when government established these sorts of funds, for example, why is it not being accessed? Is it not the best way that government are providing that money? Or how do you think in your own areas that could be better taken forward to take into account the needs of very different communities, as you've outlined?
Mike?
Well, I'm going to let Paul in as well, because I think the eligibility criteria for that fund is too limited. So it's only been open to RSLs and local authorities. And yet we know development trusts are absolutely champing at the bit to get at it, because we've got hundreds of examples where, you know, we could use that fund to acquire housing, and via local allocation policies actually address your loss of teachers, your loss of nurses, your loss of doctors, and we've seen where communities can do it, and we have actually asked for the criteria of that fund to be widened to include development trusts, because, you know, you don't have an issue, they've all got asset locks, they've all got good governance, they've all got financial records, so it's not like that money is at risk in any sense. So that ask is on the table to Scottish Government to broaden the eligibility criteria, but I know Pauline got direct examples of that.
You've done a fabulous job, Danielson. So what more can I add? I think that is exactly the problem. Do you know, within the 2040, it only mentions RSLs and local authority. Do you know, where are the development trusts within that? They're proving their worth of what they can do when the money's on the table. We're talking here about local governance, really, to be honest. You know, and dare I say, the local governance review, I think, is key to some of this. Of people being able to control that money in a more local level, it gives you that ability to do that and the flexibility to do it. But yeah, I mean, the key worker fund, open it up. I mean, it's an easy one to sort, to a certain extent. Well, I'd hope it was an easy one to sort. We've been asking for it for a long time, and it would open up the market for the development trust right across Scotland.
Just on that, so you've been asking for it for a long time, in terms of before the money was in place, or that you've been asking for that 25 million, the criteria for that to be opened up since it was announced, when was that, a year or so ago?
Yeah, so our development trusts have been sort of calling for that to be changed. So maybe not on a forum like this, but they have been lobbying for change for that for a while. So,
Do you have a sense of what the resistance is to do it? Just slow process of government? No.
I think there is some issue around that if there is a housing need in the community, then the local authority or the RSL can deal with it. But we know from what's happening on the ground that's not happening, because understandably local authorities and RSLs don't want to deal in single units because of the management costs. So they'd much rather have a group of houses together, which makes it easier for them to manage. So this is why communities are stepping into the breach, because, you know, in a small community, four houses will make all the difference. But, you know, I'm sure Bonnie would say as well that RSLs are only interested in that scale if it's in partnership with someone else.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. I mean, when we talk about the rural construction sector, it's not just building housing, it's maintaining and repairing them as well. And if you don't have a rural construction sector, the economics of owning a property is an issue. The fund allows a purchase off the shelf. That in itself can be an issue, because housing might not be at the required standard, and you're taking on liabilities to have to repair and maintain. But more flexibility and opening the fund up to communities would use the money up very quickly, and a bit more flexibility round about the Rural and Island Housing Fund would get an awful lot more projects ongoing. But we do need to deal with the underlying problem, which is lack of a construction sector, which is an opportunity to repopulate and regenerate as well.
Mike, you indicated you want to come in. Have you got anything to add?
Well, yeah, just was going to make the same points, but I mean, I think through the Rural Housing Fund, communities have really demonstrated in our smaller smaller rural areas that one property can make a huge difference to a small place in terms of bringing in the right people or providing the right services. And as Pauline says, community development trusts are really best placed to intervene around this fund and are not being given the opportunity to do so.
Okay, thanks. And I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol, who's online. Pam.
Good morning, convener, and thank you. Good morning, panel, and thank you very much for the opening statements. They have been very helpful. Obviously, you've heard that the First Minister announced a U-turn on cuts from the housing budget by pledging an extra £80 million over the next 2 years. However, that doesn't neglect the fact that this is less than the nearly £200 million cut from the affordable housing budget last December. So I wanted to ask you, what do you think that this overall cut means for the rural housing? And I've also got another question, which I'll add on as well, that we've heard in previous sessions from the witnesses that, you know, the committee's heard that generally they are, a lot of people are supportive of the aims of the 2040 strategy, but they felt that it was undeliverable, which we've obviously heard today from yourselves. So I wanted to ask the panel, is the Scottish Government housing 2040 strategy and other policy sufficiently coherent and deliverable? And I know, Mike, you had touched on that, so it may be good if you could come in on that question. Thank you.
Mike.
Around the position in cuts to the affordable housing budget, I mean, I think, you know, I'm here to talk about the work that we're doing with the Rural Housing Fund, which is the key focus for us, and that hasn't been impacted in the same way. And others may be better placed to come in on that one. I mean, I think for us the deliverability side of things is certainly not in the policy framework or in the potential pipeline of projects, and really we feel that we're in a position that there's significant opportunity to do more, particularly through non-traditional delivery routes, such as communities, but also employers as well. So really, I think the critical element around deliverability, Ronnie has mentioned a number of times, the construction sector, and the impact that cost is having on developments. I mean, I think for the work that we're doing in Southern Scotland, we really welcome the approach that's been taken through the Regional Economic Partnership. We think that partnership is vital to all of this, to addressing the skills shortfall. The challenge around costs and deliverability, we certainly feel that there are aspects of the process at the moment, particularly around the Rural Housing Fund, that could be shifted to assist quite easily the process of deliverability. And in particular, I think we wanted to highlight that there has been a change whereby full grant application into the Rural Housing Fund is now only being taken once projects have been fully tendered, which has not been the case up to this point in time. And we're deeply concerned that what that's doing is transferring the profile of risk onto the community organisations who are being asked to deliver key needs for their place, and is really likely to have a detrimental impact going forward on the future programme.
Thanks, Russell.
Yeah. I think if you look at the evidence, which is always a good thing to do, and you go back to 2008 in the south of Scotland at the time of the last financial crash, housing, private and affordable and social housing were going up in the same line. After 2008, the social one kept going, but the private one collapsed. And it goes back to the point that Ronnie's made, that we lost an awful lot of SME builders in 2008 who have never come back again. And therefore, there's a big gap in the private market. And it was really interesting when all the private sector builders, and I do mean all of them, came down to be with the Deputy First Minister in Dumfries over a year ago. They all said, if we're not making a profit, we're not coming. And a profit means, I think somebody else said, under a house, you know, 100 houses or less. So unless we start to create our own new SMEs and a business, as Ronnie said, in rural Scotland, that is going to support not just the building of affordable houses, but, as I keep saying, the building of unaffordable houses. And I don't mean that the way it sounds, but we know that people can buy. So, and therefore, I think until we do that, whatever the strategy is that government puts into place, whether it's 2040 or beyond,
we need at the essence to bring back the builders in the rural Scotland who will support all of that. And Mike, working with Mike, as we do very closely, we know one of the challenges we always have when we come to building a small number of houses is doing that. And if I can give one example of why I think we all have to remember what the real output is this. About two and a half years ago, the little community of Kirkcope, way up at the top of the Ettrick Valley, had a real problem. And the real problem was that the numbers in the primary school had fallen to a level that the primary school was about to shut. And everybody would have had to go 21 miles down the road to Selkirk to go to school. So we worked with the community to build, to convert an old steading into five houses and some incubator space. Total cost, probably about £2 million to do all that. And we put in some money at South of Scotland Enterprise. And what they were able to do was bring in five families with children. And that put up the numbers in the rural schools again. So we've got to remember in these tiny little rural communities, what the economic output will be is important. But the social outcome of making sure that, you know, people can still live there. And if that primary school had moved down to Selkirk, it would have discouraged people to come in. The young people wouldn't have wanted to stay here. So the impact of doing, as Mike said, these small things in communities around that is really, really important. And whether we have that fund or whether we do it or the council does that anyway, we're not talking about huge sums of money here in some of these communities. But the outcome, and especially working with Mike and his team, can be really quite transformational.
Great, thanks. Yeah, that story is certainly something I've heard across the Hubs and Islands. Ronnie.
Thank you, Camina. Going to budgets, I mean, a reduction in the budget is never particularly welcome, but the bigger impact I think we're finding is that current build costs are huge. They're between £300,000 and £400,000 for an affordable home. That's more than doubled in the last 5 years. And that is having the biggest impact on deliverability, and it is unsustainable unless we can we'd increase grant levels, but that's going to reduce numbers. Meeting the 2040 figures is highly unlikely now, given build costs like that. As I said earlier, policies in their own right, they look reasonable, but from our experience, I don't see many of them going to work unless we can break down some of the silos within Scottish Government and with more cross-portfolio working. Then they really do have a strong chance of working. As Mike says, a lot of the risk at the moment Scottish Government are placing on the communities, and that doesn't chime with the community wealth building and the community empowerment. There needs to be more collaborative working there. And again, if we're able to do that, be a bit more cohesive with policies, I think the opportunities are huge to work with different finance models and the business community and the service providers to deliver a lot more homes.
Can you just talk a bit about, we've talked in the past about the idea of building at scale, and I think it would be good for the committee to hear that idea and how, because I know Stuart already mentioned that whole area that you're thinking at in kind of the northwest Sutherland area. Yeah, it'd be interesting to hear where you got to with that and if you still think that that's a useful way. And it also touches on what Russell was talking about, the need to kind of rebuild SMEs since we lost them. And that could be a way of encouraging them. But if you could explain that idea.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's areas, we call them micro-regions, if you like, all the way around our area. But two specific ones in northwest Sutherland, we've got about 60 housing units potential to deliver across a number of different communities. And in Wester Ross, for example, there's about 80 housing units across a number of different communities. We're speaking to a number of very big, powerful businesses who are all prepared or at least prepared to engage in discussion about providing finance to create a local construction market, which would bring costs down, not just for affordable housing, but for public housing, for service providers, you know, building new schools or the businesses themselves, because they need facilities, and there's a lot of economic development happening in these small rural areas. But we need to coordinate all the policies and create a sector, especially a construction sector, that can help deliver all that and maintain it. We've got increasing build standards, which are laudable but unviable unless you have a sector there to deliver them. New net zero heating sprinkler systems. If we, Northwest Sutherland has to drag somebody from Glasgow up to service that once it's been installed, it just does not make sense. And it's not going to be viable for two or three houses in Durness or another three or four houses in Betty Hill. It just makes the whole economy of owning a property unviable. So we need to, again, deal with the underlying problem, which is a construction sector.
Okay, and so and just a bit more detail on that. So the idea of the builders merchants, what can you just say a bit more about that?
Well, again, our feeling is we're not using enough local materials. We're not creating a circular economy. Communities are keen, and they have facilities like of old fish markets who are not being used to their maximum. So the facilities are there. Using private business finance to stock that buildings with pre-purchased materials for house builds can bring costs down, but it can also enable the growth of smaller businesses because they don't then need to worry or about the cash flowing of materials, which can be a big risk for a small business. It would need infrastructure there, likes of main contracting role support, because the smaller businesses will struggle with potentially with the paperwork involved and procurement, but communities are up for that. And you know, Lochinver, for example, they're really, really keen to see something like this move forward, and the businesses are keen to support it. And there's some very big and wealthy communities in these areas, businesses in these areas, that are prepared to share the money, and they can benefit from that as well.
You said that we need to coordinate this. I'm paraphrasing you, but you said we. Who's the we? Like, is that something that the Scottish Government needs to take on, or is it something that's HIE? Sorry to throw work at your door, but you know, is that?
Uh-huh.
Who's
well,
the
I mean, you know, going back to the policies and the action plans, I think it lies with Scottish Government. We do need to get more flexibility in there within the policies and the action plans. I personally think a rural board, if you like, including businesses, service providers and the key stakeholders, would benefit Scottish Government. And clarify the issues, take a different approach to things, a more impact-based approach to delivery. Because if we don't start delivering very soon, the whole rural area is going to struggle, and we're going to miss opportunities in the economy.
Okay, Stuart.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I think what Ronnie's talking about is much better coordination. If we look at North West Sutherland, for example, it is a repopulation area, so it has specific focus around growing the population. We have economic opportunities through tourism investment. We also have a spaceport under development there. So there are a number of significant economic opportunities. I think what we need to see is much better join-up between housing policy and economic development. At the moment, they sit in two separate parts of government, and I think joining those together is really fundamental, particularly to address depopulation and also the economic opportunity side. I think housing in general is a great way of stimulating the economy. So house building is good news in terms of the multiplier effect it has, particularly in rural communities. I think by bringing together smaller construction projects and, you know, groups of bringing together, rather than fives and tens, you create 50s and hundreds. That then stimulates the market, gives more certainty. Bigger contractors might come in and then form partnerships with local subcontractors. At the moment, the small number of units isn't attractive to the bigger construction companies. And as Russell said, the smaller companies just aren't there. So we need something to get that going again. Mm-hmm. And I think this idea of collaborating across a number of geographic locations within a specific geography will make that, create that, you know, more more numbers, which will then stimulate the market. But I do think there needs to be better join up between housing policy and economic policy, because really at the moment they're quite separate. We need housing to support the economy and vice versa. Take the Green Freeport, for example, in around Inverness and the Cromarty Firth. We know that's going to create a significant number of jobs. We've already attracted Sumitomo to that area with hundreds of jobs. So more jobs are coming. We need to get the housing side sorted out as well to make full advantage of that opportunity. So it's about that join up and coordination. It does require Scottish Government, but it also requires local agencies such as HIE, the council, and indeed communities all to work together. And I think that can happen, actually. There are examples where that's happened and where we can make things work effectively. Thanks.
Okay. Elsa.
Thank you. Yeah, coming back to the original question, but obviously agreeing with what my colleagues have said, I think housing to 2040 was of its time. Things have moved on actually quite a bit since then, even though it's a relatively short period of time. And it wasn't actually sufficiently nuanced for rural areas. So coming back to Stuart's point about housing and economy being so closely linked in rural communities, in perhaps a way it isn't in urban communities. So in urban communities, it's much more about addressing homelessness because the private sector market will act because there are the values there and the costs are lower. But in the rural communities, the private sector is not acting, and therefore we're trying to fix a system, or we're trying to squeeze a system for urban areas into the rural communities, and it's just not working. So I think we need to step back and say, actually, we need a different approach in rural areas, and it is this whole partnership approach. And, you know, speaking from a community's perspective, communities only ever deliver anything in partnership. So they've got fantastic experience in doing that and a great willingness in doing that. But actually, we need to, just to say, step back. And I think the idea of a sort of a rural funding body, whether it's an agency or funding board, actually recognising what those differences are in rural areas and making sure that instead of trying to squeeze our problems into an urban solution, actually we find some rural solutions. Thank you.
Okay. Russell, and then I'm going to bring Pam back in because I think she's got another question.
Sorry, I was just going to build on that one as well and to say, and try and answer Pam's question. I think any change in government funding affects anybody, and I think in particular in this sector of housing companies, be they RSL or private houses, are always planning for the future. So what you do if you start to tinker with funding mechanisms, you start to introduce uncertainty into the future, into what their pipelines is, and therefore I would counsel anybody, not just in government anyway, looking at how we fund this, to ensure that what we're not talking about is building a house today, we're talking about building the houses in the future. So I was about to say something which did not sound the way I was. I don't think it particularly matters about the quantum, but it's about the changing, which changes the uncertainty. And we've heard from our own RSLs, and indeed those that supply the RSLs, that these constant changing and funding doesn't help you planning for the future when you're trying to do that. So my counsel would be not, I'm not sure it's, my colleagues will probably throw things at me in a minute, but I'm not so sure it's due to the quantum, but it's about having some consistency that if we're going to plan funding housing for the future, we need to have a certain stream of funding so that we can start. And if we're going to encourage people back to what our SMEs back, that's what they all need as well, is something to de-risk what they're going to do in the future. So we need some certainty around it.
Okay. We're going to bring in Pam, but if anyone's got anything else to add on those bits, you're welcome to tuck them in your response to the next bit. Pam.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for your responses. They have been very helpful. Obviously, we've touched on how important rural housing is in economic growth, and we're well aware that, and certainly in remote areas, sectors like renewables and space show great promise as well for growth. And this is something, even when I spoke to the local authorities in the rural areas, that they voiced that there is a lot of growth and a lot of opportunities, just like today's panel have highlighted as well. I wanted to ask the question around recruiting for public services like teaching and healthcare is also obviously tough due to the housing shortages. So I wanted to ask the panel, how does the rural housing affect public services and growth in their areas? And what role does enterprise agencies play in this?
Okay. Well, that was pointed at enterprise agencies, so initially, certainly. So Stuart and then Russell.
Okay, on you go, Stuart.
Yes, thanks very much for your question. Definitely rural areas and shortage of homes affects the ability to recruit to the public service as well. Public sector recruitment is challenged by housing availability, particularly places like the Isle of Skye, very popular with tourism, but also a challenge to recruit for nurses, for police officers, people in teaching professions as well. So enterprise agencies ourselves, we don't directly provide housing, but we do work with a lot of businesses and a lot of community groups. In the evidence I gave in advance, we're working with around 50 community bodies. About half of them are working on housing projects. And some of those housing projects are mid-market rent projects, and they're available to professionals in the public service as well as in the private sector. I wanted to touch on a successful example, which is Fort William. About 5-6 years ago, there was potential for big industrial expansion in Fort William through the smelter, and a task force was put together, and housing came up as one of the things that was really challenged. And over the past 5 years or a bit longer, there's over, I think, around 700 houses have been built in Fort William. So that's been an example of good collaboration and success. And I think that for this to be tackled, it really does need a partnership approach. I think one opportunity that the government is working on at the moment is a rural delivery plan. And I think key to that rural delivery plan should be housing. It needs to be fundamental because it's definitely affecting the ability of NHS, teaching profession, a whole range of public services are affected by recruitment and housing challenges. We also need to think about childcare as well. It's another issue that we're working. We are doing a lot in that space in rural communities because it's not just about the house. It's also about the employment opportunity and the childcare associated with it. So a range of factors. But there are, in Fort William, I would point to strong partnership, strong collaboration, leadership from Scottish Government at the time as well, which was very helpful. And lots of houses have been delivered there. Thanks.
Russell, anything to add?
I mentioned in my opening remarks that currently Dumfries and Galloway Health Board has a need for 160 properties today for the nurses, the surgeons that come in. And if they bring in locums, they are having to rent property on the holiday market, so they're paying holiday rates for coming in. So it's not encouraging to bring them in. I think where enterprise agencies play a role in this is, and we are now doing this all the time, is as we come to repurpose buildings in rural areas, and we've got a lot across rural Scotland that get repurposed, is that housing should be the first option. So as we start to look at, we're looking at one in the centre of Dumfries, which is a large site, that could be repurposed into a number of homes for professional people of all varieties, from the public sector, etc. So we are now trying to focus our communities on when they come to us with an offer to say we want you to help us repurpose a building, that housing is the first thing they look at. And we're also working on that through the work we're doing on community benefit, which is very important to the south of Scotland. Between now and 2050, we've got almost £1 billion worth coming into communities in the south of Scotland from community benefit. That will go a long way to solving some of the community problems. But it is about... So I think we have a role as enterprise agencies to encourage communities to not just look at building another art centre, and I've got nothing against art centres in the community, but looking at if they have properties that they can repurpose, can that be part of the solution to the housing problem?
Okay, thanks. Mike, and then Ailsa.
point just to raise quickly, and I know you've heard me say this before, convener, I think we face an issue, particularly in the south of Scotland, around how we define rural. Relative to the funding streams, eligibility through the Rural Housing Fund applies to communities below 3,000, but it also applies to communities up to 10,000 that are within more than half an hour's drive of a 10,000 population. As Russell said earlier on, we only have two communities that are four in Dumfries and Galloway, four that are above 10,000. But none of those other communities fall into that half-hour drive classification. But it would be impossible to characterise any of those places as having anything other than a rural economy. And in all those places, we know there are communities seeking to tackle housing issues, particularly in town centres, particularly through empty buildings. that don't have that opportunity. And just to link that back to the issue of key workers, employment and key services, we find more often than not that those individuals want to live in the smaller towns, but we're lacking eligibility around communities being able to intervene in housing in those locations.
So just before I bring in Elsa on that, so do we need to do a bit of work around that definition to improve it so it really reflects?
That would be welcome, yes.
Yeah, I think we being the Scottish Government really, but we can see if they could take it on. So Elsa and then Ronnie.
Yeah, just quickly, we've made the point already about the Key Workers Fund, but and the people that suffer most from not having a teacher or a doctor or a nurse are the local communities, and they see that at first hand, and they're absolutely desperate to provide housing so they can keep their local teacher, doctor or nurse. So I think the Key Worker Fund, if we were able to open up the eligibility of that to development trusts, would have a massive impact, because Ronnie's already mentioned that base costs for building now are £300,000 and possibly up to £400,000, £500,000 in islands. And yet you could probably buy a house for £250,000 of the same. So because that's the issue why the private market is not working, is because values are much lower than the actual cost of building. So it would seem really obvious, actually, why don't we just buy existing houses when they come on the market? Why can't we use the Key Worker Fund to buy existing houses? You know, the work that's been done on short-term lets, and potentially if there is an opportunity to do more work on second homes, might bring more of those houses. So we've got the issue that actually we could deal with a lot of this by buying existing stock. We've also obviously got the added on benefit of sort of the planning rules on new housing, which can be a bit tricky, and the new building warrant rules, but also the embedded carbon in existing housing. You know, if it's used for a short-term let or a second home, is only an occupation for 20 weeks of the year, that's a really poor use of our assets in Scotland, and actually we need to make a much better use of those existing assets. So one solution won't deal with everything, but actually there's lots and lots of opportunities here of things that are already happening and that could be scaled up without significant greater call on existing budgets, but we just need a bit more flexibility. And it comes back to the point I think we've all been making, is actually it needs to be outcomes focused. What are we trying to achieve? It's not numbers of units, but actually what is the long-term outcome of what the work that we're all doing here, and there's lots of different ways of doing that. It's not all just new build. Thank you.
Yeah, and actually I really appreciate you bringing in the point that we've got existing housing stock, and how do we actually make that work better and help people who are stuck in big houses that are too big for them, wanting to downsize? How do we create that kind of space for people to move? And also, I think 80% of Scotland's, we're also, in terms of what we face in terms of the climate emergency, we really need to be looking at the existing housing stock and the whole piece around retrofitting that as well. So it's another bit of the puzzle, which is really quite challenging in rural communities. But
Can I mention, the whole issue of rural housing burdens, and we've not really touched on them yet. But again, that's another function that is available that we know works, we could actually make much better use of. So a community that I'm involved with, there is a house owner there that's had it as the house as a second home or a holiday home. And they're really keen for that to go to the community. And so actually, if there was a way of scaling up the use of rural housing burdens, which keep houses in permanent residential use, you know, that's something we already have. As I say, we have a lot of these things already. It's just how we have the flexibility to scale them. Sorry, Ronnie.
Okay. Ronnie.
Yeah. Opposite to Russell there, rather than having to encourage communities to work with service providers, we find communities are really keen to support. They're wanting to create placemaking opportunities. So, you know, communities like of Strontium, for example, have built a community-owned school. Staffin have built a community-owned health centre. And I think if, again, going back to the different portfolios and silos, If we can get all the different agencies working with communities better, there could be a lot more delivery and a lot more efficiencies for all sectors, whether it's health, education, or housing. Staffing's got a bit of everything there. It's got economic, and it was supported by HIE as well. It's got economic, it's got health, and it's got different tenures in housing. The models are there, like what here, and communities are able to do it, and it's a similar issue with the rural housing burden. The Rural and Island Housing Action Plan promised to help with the rural housing burden. Unfortunately, that's not happened, and we don't have a designated person in Scottish Government to speak to about that yet. We're pushing hard because we do need to get that discussion going. We've developed a legacy model, just as Ailsa suggests there. A lot of altruistic people want to transfer existing houses into the affordable market, but without some assistance and improvements on the lending for rural housing burdens, that's not going to happen. And we need Scottish Government assistance in discussion with lenders. But they do need us as part of that discussion. We get the feeling they don't want us at that table to discuss, but it's, we have to be there.
You get the feeling that the Scottish Government doesn't want you at the table to discuss it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, just clarifying that.
Yeah.
You also say there that you have a sense that you need a designated person to talk from the Scottish Government to be able to discuss the benefits that rural housing burden could bring.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Pauline.
I mean, I think that there's lots of great suggestions coming out here, and I think which is great with the funding, the planning and various other things that need to be improved for big communities. But the one thing I want to stress, and I was going to come in the last time, was just about the support for communities to do this. These people they can and will do it, you know, and can, you know, have prime examples of the building the schools, building the houses, key worker accommodation, etc. But this is a lot of hard work for communities. I mean, you're hearing about it all over, about burnout, fatigue, etc. These legislative changes with funding and planning need to change quickly to make this happen, so that it's not more of a burden and disempowering of communities, because the stress they go under for it. So I want to sell that they can do it and celebrate how much communities are achieving, but I also want to stress that we can't keep putting more onto communities without the extra support and advice and legwork, advice on being able to navigate that whole process. It's not easy, you know, these are local people who are not specialists in housing, but they are learning as they go, and with the proper right and support, and is where we've got the success stories. So I just want to stress that there has to be that support mechanism around this. This doesn't just happen, So I just want to say that, because I think we've got some really good suggestions with the housing, local boards and planning and various other things that need to be improved. But let's not forget the support behind that requires to navigate the process.
Okay. Absolutely. Take that on board. I just want to, before we bring in, I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey in a moment and to kind of pursue the planning bit a little bit further. But I just want to pick up on the kind of, we're going to kind of explore in the economic development bit. And I think we're going to maybe talk more about the Rural and Island Housing Fund in a moment too. But in the high submission, you talked about a strategic planning exercise. I thought that was quite interesting, and it's already been touched on a bit. The idea that the kind of more joined up approach, working together with stakeholders, and that would include ministers or officials from economy, planning, business support, rural homes, divisions, all in the same room at the same time to consider a joined up strategic response to both the economic boom and the rural housing crisis that we face. I just wonder, because I think in some of our papers somewhere I read that the Scottish Government indicated that they are working both with High and SOCI around economic and housing issues, but have you had any traction with the idea of a strategic planning exercise?
Yes, thanks, Convener. We're undertaking some research at the moment looking at the scale of the economic opportunity in the Highlands and Islands. We have many growth sectors, particularly renewables. Frankly, to get to net zero needs the Highlands and Islands, for Scotland to get to net zero, needs the Highlands and Islands energy supply, and the same applies to the UK. So huge amounts of renewables are going to come from our region, and that's going to power the economy, but that won't work unless we have the people there to staff the industries to drive that change. So we are undertaking a piece of research at the moment, looking at the scale of the job numbers that will come, and that then obviously creates demand for temporary accommodation, but also permanent accommodation, new homes. That will feed in through our regional economic partnership, and the Scottish Government is placing more emphasis now on regions, where there's a refresh of the national strategy for economic transformation happening. We're certainly saying that it needs to have a strong regional focus, because it needs to reflect the needs of all of Scotland, not just the central belt. So we're optimistic that that research will create more inroads into government policy than has happened in the past. I mentioned the need to join up the different strands of government. We had JP Marks, who's the head of the civil service in Scotland, in Inverness last summer. We talked to him about the scale of the opportunity, and he talked about the need to bring together housing, transport, economy. And so I'm optimistic that that will happen. We obviously need to undertake the research, but we're talking about several thousand jobs, possibly into the tens of thousands of jobs needed to support the renewable energy change that we've got and the sector coming. And we've already seen some inward investment. There's more to come. So that does need to join up between housing, economy and transport. Thanks.
OK, thanks. Russell.
If I may, we've been since COS decided that we, and the REP decided that housing would be one of our grand challenges, and the Deputy First Minister gave it to me personally as one of my personal objectives to solve housing in the south of Scotland, which was nice of him. We've had a team, which Gary's part of, who's sitting beside and behind me, looking at all of this. And we will launch our regional housing plan through the REP in June. And we've had great support, I have to say, from Scottish Government officials in doing that. And we've spoken to everybody that ever it was in housing, infrastructure, etc. And Mike's been a good part of this as well. So we are now at the point where we think we can see a way of doing this, but it's not going to be short term. It's going to take time, and it's going to be, so there is about rebuilding our SMEs, there's about focusing all our investment better, there's about creating the right conditions, and that goes back to planning and making sure we have the right people. It's about training. So in June this year we will launch the South of Scotland's Housing Action Plan, which is a subset of the regional economic strategy which we have in place already, which will put that forward based on a huge amount of evidence that we've brought together, which we'd be happy to share with the committee if they would like that in the future.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with a couple of questions.
Thanks very much, convener. As I listened to you this morning, I sometimes wish I could transport you back 40 years so that the decision makers then, who embarked on a process of selling off 500,000 houses in Scotland, could see the impact of that. And all your discussions around the table now are about this crisis, about building more homes in Scotland, making them available. And one of the big elephants in the room, as we all know, is the huge cut in the capital budget that will allow us to recover that slightly or even get close to the targets that we all seek. And quite a bit of ingenuity is being spread around the table too, and it's great to hear this. But do you think those different ranges of ingenuity that will be sufficient to get us to where we need to be? We're talking about funds to reacquire empty properties, and the First Minister announced the £80 million extra that Pam mentioned. Last year that programme was introduced with £60 million and it brought back 1,000 properties at relatively low cost. And Ailsa, you were telling us about the cost of constructing a new house, but there are other ways of trying to do this. So I suppose my question to you is, are these different ranges of measures that are available to us going to be sufficient, do you think, to get us where we want to be? And the measures I'm talking about are the measure that Mike mentioned, the council tax supplement in Dumfries and Galloway, is helping you to put funding in a certain place to use that to build up numbers. Long-term voids, second homes that you've all mentioned, many of those council houses, Russell, and Gatehouse of Fleet are now second homes, I'm prepared to bet. So do we need to be more innovative about the measures that we can deploy to try to improve the situation, do you think? Maybe start with Russell, if I may.
Thank you, Ollie. Goodness me. I don't think there's a simple answer to your question, and I'm not trying to avoid answering it, because I think this is a very complex subject. People need housing. As Stuart eloquently put, we need, if we're going to, both our economic and development agencies will fail over the next X years if we don't have housing to put all the people we want to come into. We'll lose our young people. So it's a big issue. It is about building the right housing. I was speaking to
a friend of mine who runs one of the biggest RSLs in the UK a month ago, and I asked him what's wrong, what's the issue with the housing market in the UK. He said, we've got all the wrong type of houses and they're all built in the wrong place. And there is a whole part of this that says, now, do we really need to look at the type of housing that we want to have across the whole of Scotland? Taking that each... So if I go to New Galloway, which will probably only need 12 houses over the next 10 years, they will encourage self-builders to come in because they want them to be part of their community. Other communities will grow some small RSL. Will more money help? Maybe is the answer, and I'm not trying to avoid the question. Maybe, because without, as Ronnie's mentioned eloquently many times, without the people, without the SMEs to build them all, we're going to struggle. We have the land, so I'm not getting any issues around the land. So I just think this is a complicated problem. That's why we took a year out to go away and think about this, because there isn't an easy answer. And it is going to take us over a long period of time. And we haven't even got into the area, I think, that Ailsa raised, about retrofitting. I mean, if we really want to do that properly, the RSLs reckon that that's, in the south of Scotland, what, Mike, and you'll put me right if I get this right, about 30,000 a house to retrofit a pre-1980 house to get it back up to the standard we want. So I think, yes, of course, there was more capital budget, you could do more, but I don't think there's a simple answer to your question, Elaine. I wasn't trying to avoid answering it. I just think it's complicated.
Yeah.
Okay. Pauline and then Ailsa.
I'm not going to comment on the type of housing because I'm not technically, I don't know the ins and outs of all of that, but I'm going to say about the financing though. I think we are being creative, and I think communities are looking at community shares, community bonds, we're looking at community wealth funding and various other things to be able to match funding that Scottish Government can have. So I think there is a creativity there. I don't think it's all the answer, but we're going some way to do it. And there's some prime examples of community share programmes across Scotland being able to raise the finance in alternative ways. I did mention SNIB downstairs before I came up here, and I don't know what their role is, but in any of this, but I think there should be a role, and it made much more affordable. But SNIB, in a few meetings that I go to, gets mentioned, and everyone sort of groans, not knowing really what to do about that. But I think there's an answer in there, surely, of being able to match funds, community shares, and various other finance models that communities have got to make this happen. So.
Mm. Yeah, great. Now, thanks so much for bringing both community shares into the conversation and SNIB. And maybe we can come back to SNIB as well. So Ailsa, and then Mark Griffin wants to come in with a supplementary, and then I've got Ronnie, I think, and Stuart.
Yeah, thank you. I think we don't need to keep reinventing the wheel. We always talk about innovation because we've not solved the problem, or we need to innovate. Well, actually, we don't. We just need to scale up what the successes already are. And Pauline's talked about community finances. Communities are brilliant at raising money from all sorts of different sources. So how do we make that easier for them? How do we make it easier for us to use the existing funding to buy existing properties? How do we scale up the work that CHT and South of Scotland are doing? Because that's actually proven to deliver. So we shouldn't always be looking for the next new thing. We should be looking at what's working and then think, how do we use the budgets that we've got, which we know are constrained? Nobody's saying we want billions more. How do we use that money better? And I think you can only do that at a regional level. You cannot do it at a national level because, as Russell said, the problems in the south of Scotland are different than the problems in Highland Islands. Not a land issue in the south of Scotland. There is a land issue in the Highlands and Islands. So actually access to land is a problem. You know, communities all across Scotland are really willing because it affects them on a day-to-day basis. So how do we support them better to do more of this? So I think if you could actually devolve some of this to whether it's regional economic partnerships or whatever the structure is, or regional funding boards, they would say, right, these are the 30 options available to us, which we know work. What are the best ones for us here? And actually be able to do that on a much more local basis, rather than assume that a national approach is always best, because a national approach isn't always best.
Okay. Mark, do you want to come in at this moment?
Yes, thanks, Gavin. It was just following up on Willie's question on, you know, best use of existing homes, and I think I've heard every single member of the panel talk about the proliferation of second or holiday homes. Now, the government have looked at one side of the tax equation in that, on increasing council tax on those who own second homes. But I wonder if they should also look at the other side of the tax equation, which is when that holiday home has been purchased. Now, we have additional dwelling supplement, which is in place, which means that You know, people who are buying a rented property or other things must pay a supplement on the land and building transaction tax. I wonder if, given the particular issues that you're raising, that there should be a specific category for holiday homes or second homes for additional dwelling supplement that would maybe start to affect behaviour change, particularly in a rural setting.
I'm going to keep with the order I've got, so Ronnie and Stuart. So if that's not something you want to necessarily pick up, don't worry, because you had the original question that came from Ronnie, but I think it was like that came from Willie, which but I think Mark's adding another idea on the innovation. But we've also heard from Elsa already, like, we don't need innovation, we need to just scale up what we're doing. So come in with what you want.
I would agree with Elsa. I think that there is no need to reinvent the wheel. There is a lot of innovation out there. There's a lot of good projects we can learn from. I would be confident in saying that we can deliver units, but it needs flexibility. And there needs to be a bit of give and take. Businesses, for example, want to be involved. They've got finance, but they need some relaxations, for example, in tenures. So, you know, security of tenure is at the moment a no-go for Scottish Government, and we understand that. But at the same time, if we're going to deliver economic housing, we need to have a slightly more flexible model that will allow businesses to be involved and make sure there is housing there.
And the flexible model you're talking about is within the Rural and Island Housing Fund specifically, or in general?
In general. Mm. I mean, businesses are nervous about they can't partner the public sector just now on delivery of housing. And I think being able to use private finance from businesses alongside an element of public subsidy would make a lot of projects much more viable and take a big strain off the public budget, meaning we'd deliver a lot more. But it would require Scottish Government to be more flexible around about 10 years. And you know, I'm not saying to forget about security of tenure. That's absolutely not what I'm saying. But there are tweaks that would work for businesses and Scottish Government, I feel. But it needs flexibility to provide that.
What kind of tweaks do you?
I think I took you around the national park and suggested, more area-based security of tenure, so you can move between businesses as long as you work within that area, because that again works with the environment. So that if you have to commute too far, then you do need to vacate the property. So there's halfway houses, if you like. And I think more flexibility, and that would allow investment from businesses and reduce the burden on the public funding.
Okay, thanks, Stuart.
Yes, I think Willie's referral back to history is quite interesting. If you look at what happened in the 1970s around the Inner Moray Firth area, many thousands of houses were built to accommodate workers at Ardseer and Nigg, and these fabrication yards at one point had around 8,000 to 10,000 people working in them. So lots of housing was produced in relatively short time. So I'm always optimistic. I think there are plenty of methods around. We just need to focus more on delivery. It's got to be about actually building more houses. Mm-hmm. I think purchasing existing stock is fine, but in many rural communities there isn't enough stock. So we need more new build. So I think it has to be a mix. I'm very keen on what Ailsa says about a regional approach here. Because it's going to be a mixed economy. Some of it will be delivered by communities, some by councils, some by RSLs, and some by the private sector. So we have Scottish and Southern Energy, for example, talking about building 200 homes in association with their network upgrades, which is excellent. So we need a mixed economy approach, but it has to have a regional focus. One tweak that I think government could make is that we have an excellent office, part of Scottish Government, dealing with homes in Highland, but actually in Argyll and Bute it's dealt with from the Glasgow office. Now if the Highland office, who also deal with the islands, could deal with Argyll, that would solve quite a few issues, because they're very used to dealing flexibly with island communities, whereas the Glasgow office obviously don't deal with islands very often. So there are some tweaks that can be done. I strongly favour a regional approach to this, working through national strategy for transformation on a regional basis, thinking about how many houses do we need to produce to support the economy, and really being focused on delivery. That's what it's all about. So there's plenty of innovation. We've got Cairngorms, for example, the businesses there have worked together. There's great innovation. We just need more of it, and we need to do it more quickly.
Thanks very much. Really, really helpful, interesting answers to some of the points raised there. But we also got into the land availability issue that seems to be different from the south of Scotland to the north of Scotland. So I'd just invite some further comments about what the differences are and what the impacts are. And lastly, probably from me, what more can we do to tackle the empty houses issue? Russell, you told us that 30% of the gatehouse fleet are second home. I presume they're mostly empty most of the time. I'm not sure you can enlighten us about that, but there are plenty of properties that are not lived in Scotland. There's loads of them, long-term voids that the councils have. Do we need a solution for that? But firstly, on the land availability issue, perhaps in the south and the north of Scotland, just to contrast that for the members, would be very welcome, please.
Can I kick off, convener? Well, Guy's writing me my answer on the land one, which we'll do in a second. Let me answer the last question you put about the number of houses and the gatehouse fleet. It's interesting, and if I can answer Mark's question as well, my own personal view is, and this is my personal view, so I state that, to make a real impact on those, you'd have to make the council tax 10 times what it is. Because if you can afford to buy a second home, you can, doubling the council tax makes no difference to really one way or another, my view. So I think we have to impact on those. Willie, a lot of them are empty. And if you not just gatehouse of fleet, there are streets in Kipford. If you walk along in the winter, you'll see no lights on at all. And it's the harm that does the community over time. I mean, this is not just an issue for Scotland. They're dealing with it in Cornwall and in Cumbria and all over the place. And there are some, whether it's you tax the people when they buy it, or whether you actually put quotas, I hate to use the word, but quotas on, you know, how many houses can do that, I don't know. But it is an issue. And it's also an issue for another reason. It's becoming divisive in the communities. So communities, you now have in some of our communities, and I've sat in meetings in town halls at night where the people that have moved in and bought some of those from time to time have a totally different view on where the community want to go. Thanks, Guy. A totally different view on where they want that community to go than the people are there. So it's causing divisiveness in our little local communities. And if I may, and be very direct, I was at a community meeting in a place not far from Dalbeattie, usually, and a person stood up, banged the table, and said, "I didn't move here so that you could change." And I think that's a big issue that some of the communities have now. So it is, the point you make about empty houses is really good. But I think the other thing is we have to consider the impact it makes in the communities. But if we really are going to do this, we're going to have some big grown-up adult discussions about how we do this and whether we go in and try and interfere in the housing market to do that or put really severe financial penalties on people seeking people. But I will now answer the bit of land. It's a lack of developers we have. So we've got plenty of land. It's just a lack of developers. So that's why... So there's always been land, I suppose, Willie. And what has happened since the 2008, we've lost our SME builders who would go in and pick up those bits of land. They're not big enough for the private developers to come in and pick up because they only want to build 100 or 50 houses at a time. These are for a dozen. So land's always been there. It's not... It's just... Pre-2008, we had a group of SMEs who would go and see, I can build four houses in that plot of land. And a lot of them went, and a lot of them now aren't willing to take the risk to do that. We're beginning to see some more of that, especially along the Solway coast. But the land, the answer to the question is a strained answer. It's always been there. It's just we've lost the bit that used to buy it to do that.
OK. Is compulsory purchase part of the equation in strengthening compulsory purchase powers? Heels at you.
Obviously, but...
you go. Actually, so if you could all really indicate clearly when you want to come in. I was going to bring you in. Yeah. If you could also come back in on the additional dwelling supplement, because I think you indicated and I didn't catch you earlier, if you want to.
Yes, yeah.
On that, and then also address the land piece.
Thank you. And we'll perhaps address that first. So I think the point that Russell made, twice council tax is neither here nor there, really. It gets a bit of extra income for local authority, but it's not, will not stop people buying second homes, particularly when the values are so much lower than where their first home is. So I think you either do a very punitive rate of council tax, or you look at the planning system. And Community Land Scotland did do some work, actually funded by HIE, looking at the planning system and how actually you can start to identify second homes and look at putting caps of second homes in certain communities where there's particular housing pressure. So I think that really needs to be looked at again, because that is a route available to the Scottish Government. I think the other issue around sort of short-term lets is that so many of them don't pay council tax, don't pay business rates, because they get small business rates for these, so they're not actually making any contribution. So that is something that could be addressed really quickly, and that at least then they are making a contribution to services that their users are using locally. I think picking up again on Russell's point, we do see people that buy a second home in a place because they really like that place, and they actually don't want to see new houses built, and they're not really bothered if the school closes because they don't use it anyway, or if there's no doctor because they don't use it. So again, it comes back to this planning issue as to how many second homes and short-term lets are viable in a community. And I think local communities should have the opportunity to comment on that. And at the moment, they don't. So we've all got examples. You've mentioned some in the south of Scotland, you know, Plockton, a beautiful place, but 40% of the housing stock is short-term let or holiday homes, and most of the houses on the front street, which is a prime spot, holiday homes. So we need, again, we do have the tools available to us, but we need to support communities in using those tools. So I think that's a sort of second home issue. Coming back to land, two points I'd like to make, really, particularly in the Highlands and Islands, we still have a hugely concentrated pattern of land ownership, which you'll all be aware of, and there's a fantastic community up in the northwest where the local estate, which is a charitable trust, owns 26,000 hectares all around this particular community, which is very vibrant, and there was no land available of housing, so the community had to buy less than an acre from NHS to build three small houses. Now, where's the equity in that? If you've got a charitable trust which owns 26,000 hectares and it cannot make 1 acre of land available for housing. So that absolutely needs to be addressed. And the Land Reform Bill will give us some opportunities to do that. The only other point I'd make is obviously around community ownership, and we've seen where communities own their own land, whether that's Egg or Gear or in Knoydart, West Harris, the population is going back up. The demographic is changing because those communities are seeing that what the big issue is you need more housing of the right type in the right place, and they've got the land to do it. So I think land is a massive issue, but again, there are solutions.
Can I, just before I bring you in, Ronnie, I just want to ask Ailsa, on the second homes and the idea that the planning system could put a cap on that, would you imagine that sits in the local development plans or the local place plans, or where would that...
Yeah, so local place plans quite often talk about numbers of short-term lets and second homes. But at the moment, obviously, in the short-term let licensing, there was a proposal to include limits, and that was taken out almost at the last minute. So it'd be really good if that could be reintroduced when the short-term let review, and that communities could say, look, we all know we need short-term lets. They're an integral part of the tourism industry, but actually we need a limit on them. We cannot just keep getting more and more and more. And local place plans quite often talk about that. We've got the function through the short-term let planning control area orders to do that, and that's obviously being tested now in Edinburgh in Highland Council. There are other communities that want to do it, but again, all the focus, and coming back to Pauline's point, communities have to push it. Groups of volunteers have to say, look, our community is dying because 40% of our houses are not used, and they're having to push local authorities, push Scottish Government in the face of massive industry pressure, and you know, a lot of personal grief comes the way of communities that want to do this, and we need to make that system easier. So all of these tools are available. It's, we need to just think, well, how can we make it easier? How can we make it more flexible for people to actually have a say over what's happening in their local community and not be subject to all these external forces over which they have no control?
Okay, thanks. We're almost coming up to 11. I would like to extend this maybe by 15 or 20 minutes, if that's okay with everybody. I think we've got a few more questions, and I think you've certainly got plenty more to say, and it's important for us to get that on the record. So, Ronnie, come on in.
Yeah, and on your question on land, I mean, land reform has certainly helped. Maybe not so much in practice, but just the fact that it's there can assist in negotiations with landowners. I think similar to the proposal with working with businesses, there needs to be a bit of flexibility. And you know, we've got examples and like Sir Rothie Marcus working with a landowner there and a planning system that was prepared to work with a landowner. We were able to deliver 66% affordable housing, protected by 65% of the market value. That was enabled by the rural housing burden, and it required no public subsidy at all. And more of that, there was a benefit to the landowner, absolutely, but the public sector and the affordable housing sector had a huge benefit there. And there's more examples of that can happen, and it is happening. Empty homes, again, more flexibility required. There are models there, and we've proposed repairing lease models, almost like a self-build for existing housing. We've not been able to get that through the system at the moment, but there are models that can help, and there is no silver bullet, but a mix of all these different options could really impact on empty homes. Things like the Legacy Fund, all these things can play a part, but we do need flexibility.
Just before I bring Mike in, I just want to kind of deepen that question a little bit, because I'm aware that in England, so I think many of us were at the Rural Housing Scotland conference, and I was talking to Craig White, I think his name is, who's an architect based in England, and he was mentioning that there's a requirement in England, a piece of legislation, for local authorities to keep a land register that would be specifically for communities, self-build and community build. Do we have something like that in Scotland?
There is a requirement on planning department to keep a register of self-build. Yeah.
For self-build?
Yeah.
Of land?
Yeah.
So we have something that if somebody wanted to do a self-build, or a community wanted to do a self-build, they could go to the planning authority and say, we want to do self-build, where's the land? And the local authority, the planning authority, would have to show that.
Yes, I'm pretty sure they do, yeah.
Okay, I need to maybe follow up on that. Okay, Mike.
I think around the issue of land, not that I want to contradict Russell's view around there being land for development, but I think around the conversation about barriers, potential barriers to delivery, I think it's really important to remember that in many of the community, the projects that we're supporting with communities, what communities are tackling are by no means the most straightforward sites, and are very often either the most difficult sites, or, I mean, certainly a lot of our work with communities has been around long-term vacant and derelict buildings in rural town centres. Communities are tackling things that nobody else will tackle. So they're not commercially attractive. There's a reason that the private development market or RSLs or whoever aren't stepping in and tackling a small rural centre site for 3 units or a hotel that's been semi-derelict for 30 years. And then to place all of that risk on the community and make it more difficult for them to find their way through that process is obviously counterproductive. So I think it's just important, I'm not suggesting that the land's not there, but I think it's important to remember that those areas where communities are intervening are not always either the most deliverable or the most straightforward, but they are projects that have significant regenerative and placemaking impact.
Yeah, certainly a Herculean effort that communities are taking on board there. Just want to see if anyone else wants to come in on either the land or the additional dwelling supplement, anything there. Stuart.
Thanks. On land supply, I think it's important to distinguish between land that's allocated and land that's effective, because often infrastructure costs are significantly higher, particularly in West Coast locations. You have lots of peat and lots of rock, so there might be land allocated, but can it actually be used? The other thing we haven't touched on is infrastructure costs, things like power supply, water and sewage. All of these things can be significantly higher. So you might have land allocated, but is it actually economically viable or going to be able to be used. I think the other thing which has been touched on is community empowerment can work positively, but there also can be negatives where you have anti-development voices, and this has been touched on, that can actually hold up effective house delivery. And we do see that in some communities where groups of residents decide that they don't want any more housing or they don't want affordable housing, and that can stop things. So community empowerment needs to be careful to balance the needs of people who are voiceless or not there, the young folk who can't move into that community because there isn't housing. So I think there's a bit of a balance needed in that. But on land supply, I think, as Ailes has mentioned, a lot of it does come down in the Highlands and Islands to the owners and the attitude of the owners. If the owner is positive and wants to support the community, wants to support the school, then land can be available. If the opposite is the case, then we can see communities that are stymied and stifled. And the community ownership model has really transformed places like Egg, Gia. These populations are twice what they were under private ownership. I think Mark's point around the additional tax on second homes, absolutely, particularly if that's ring-fenced for new build, for more development, because I think that's the key, is increasing the supply of housing in many of these locations. So if that additional money can be used to support further development, then I think that would be good. And Highland Council used that for many years, by the way, on the second and holiday homes, the second home tax. There was a possibility of a discount. They didn't give it, and they used that money to build more housing.
Okay, great. I'm now going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'll direct my first question to Mike and to Russell, but I'm happy for anybody else to comment. The Rural Community Housing Bodies have been awarded funding from the Scottish Government and Nationwide, £960,000 of funding, jointly with the Nationwide Foundation for Communities Housing Trust and South of Scotland Community Housing, and that's over 3 years to develop housing projects. So I'm just wondering, what have you been able to do or plan to do with that money?
Can I just clarify? I think you meant Ronnie and Mike, yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Mike.
Okay. The two enablers entered into three-year funding package from June 23, of which we are immensely grateful. And continues our long-term relationship with the Nationwide Foundation as well. I think what's significant about that funding is it's allowing us to support our organisational resource, which has been massively stretched relative to the amount of communities we've been engaging with, and is oriented towards us being able to develop a significant pipeline of new projects that will lead to future application to the Rural Housing Fund. And I think in terms of impacts, at this stage, I shall let Ronnie speak for himself, but I think between the two organisations, we're developing a really significant pipeline of new projects. And certainly for SOSH, we're engaged with about 50 individual communities at the moment, 30-odd individual projects in development. So it's been really positive. And I think our concern at the moment is, as we develop that pipeline, the challenges that we're facing around the deliverability and getting future projects to site and through the system, particularly driven by cost. But I think what that development of the pipeline is very clearly demonstrating is that there is huge potential to upscale and do more, and reiterating the point about not needing to reinvent the wheel around this. There are so many communities, but also employers and charitable trusts wanting to engage with this process, to engage with the Rural Housing Fund, to deliver localised solutions, and we need to be able to capture that potential effectively.
On that there as well, has part of that been about supporting the building of capacity within communities themselves? Has that been a factor?
Yes. I mean, I think that I shall let Ronnie speak for himself, but we work with communities throughout the whole process. So we engage with communities to help develop the project, but give them that consistent support and expertise around capacity building.
Ronnie?
Yeah, I mean, like Mike says, we're extremely grateful for that funding. Our major concern at the moment is about delivery now, because we can build that pipeline and there's hundreds of houses in across hundreds of communities now waiting to go there. We just talked about 60 in North West Sutherland and 80 in Wester Ross, and that's just a small snapshot of the projects that are there. The land's been identified, the 10 years, we know what's required, but actually delivering it, and that is a real, well, worry for me as a CEO of an enabler. What we don't like doing is building expectations and then not delivering on it, especially when the need is so great. Like I say, the demand and the need is growing, but the delivery is slowing. We need to work very, very quickly now to grow the construction sector, repopulate, regenerate areas, and get this housing delivered.
Is there anyone else wanting to come in there? Sorry. Going to move on to Mark Griffin.
Sorry. Oh. For the question.
Oh, you've got another one. Sorry.
Got time here. No, that's fine. I'll make it quite quick. So the Scottish Government are looking for rural communities, housing bodies to become self-sufficient. And I'm just wondering how realistic people feel that aim is, and if it is realistic, how that could actually be achieved. Thanks.
I feel it's very realistic under the current systems, not so, but with flexibility and the ability to use a range of delivery models which have been tried and tested, we can do that. Speaking for CHT, before Brexit especially, we were able to grow our incomes from models. We didn't need that finance, that funding from Scottish Government or nationwide to do it. We were because projects were actually on the ground, we were able to have a sustainable model that could get our income. Because of inflexibility and the problems we have in the construction sector at the moment, that model isn't working. But it could, quite confidently, provide an opportunity for communities to be a lot more sustainable. But it does need change, systemic change, to happen quickly.
Mike, anything to add?
Yeah, I mean, just to reiterate that point, I think, you know, we are both working on our business models constantly. It's important, I think, for us to be clear that we have to achieve a balance around where our income comes from, because our organisations cannot operate as consultancies. We have to be able to work with communities. I think it's been mentioned here that these projects can take a very long time. If we're going to be there providing consistent support over 3, 4, 5 years with a community organisation, we can't limit our support to consultancy fee model, but there are fee earning opportunities for us, but they really come at the delivery stage. So we need to be progressing projects to the build.
Okay, great. Before I bring in Mark, I think we've touched in quite a lot of the area that you're going to bring up, but before I bring Mark in, we're kind of coming to the end, so I'll bring in Mark and then we'll come back round and see if there's anything else you think. So I'm giving you all a little alert here before we close, if there's anything that you think we need to hear about. I mean, one thing that I'm interested in is about Stuart, you touched on this, the kind of the housing needs and demands assessment and how that works for rural. That would be interesting to hear about. Also, I'm interested in hearing about there's going to be an upcoming asset transfer review, whether that, and speaking with one of your colleagues, Ailsa, Carrie Doyle, she was talking about the need for a coherent framework for all the tools for communities. And it would be interesting to hear maybe a little bit about that. And issues around the fact that communities need to be working with actually really looking and reading legislation to understand what they're supposed to be doing. So the difficulties around that, and can we make that easier? So those are just a few areas, and others, you might have other things that we haven't gone into at all, but I just want to really give you that opportunity. But so Mark, do you want to come in with your question?
Yep. Thanks, Convener. Like Convener said, we've touched on the topic of my question already, and it's about the government's affordable housing supply programme. The government have a long-term target of 110,000 additional homes by 2032. Take this year's budget aside, the government have still said that they plan to hit that. But I'm more interested in the 10,000 rural homes target, and just, you know, to go across the panel and ask whether that 10,000 target is still feasible. You know, if it's not, what needs to change to make that happen? Let's just go from left to right, Ronnie first.
At the moment, no, I would say it's not feasible, because there's not enough flexibility, and there's too much confusion around about mixing the mainstream budget with the rural and island housing fund budget. I think there needs to be clarity on there. There needs to be more flexibility and less risk placed on communities. There needs to be a bit of give and take with things like of landowners and with businesses. But if we could tweak some of that, it's not massive changes, and it's happened before, it's been working. If we could get back to where it has been, it is deliverable, and it would bring costs down, and the budgets would not be a strain.
Okay, Elsa.
I suppose my question is it the right target now? We've already said that was set several years ago, and Stuart's already mentioned the massive opportunities that are available in South Scotland and Highlands and Islands. So the work that HIE and no doubt South Scotland are doing on thinking about that demand, maybe more than 11,000 we actually need now, because that would have been based on need. And coming back to the convener's point about the housing needs and demand assessment, the system at the moment is need-led. So it's about what is the need in that community? And if no one has said, I'm homeless, there's no need. But of course, we all know that masks huge issues, as well as the opportunities for demand. So I would say, is it the right target? How are we thinking about that target now? We've talked a lot today about community-led housing, but we need to think about all tenure housing. So how can we encourage more private sector delivery, and what are the mechanisms for doing that? And that was actually not really addressed at all in either of those strategies, I don't think. And then there are other things going on that we've mentioned already around land reform and making more land available via perhaps the potential allotting of the land reform bill. That will bring some more land and opportunities, and perhaps more land that is suitable for development. Again, picking up Stuart's point that sometimes land is allocated, it's not suitable for development. Actually, the allotting process under the land reform bill could actually identify land that's suitable for development. So I think there are, as we mentioned already, there are tools there that we need to think about in more detail, but I think the target perhaps needs looked at again. I'm not convinced we'll meet the 11,000, certainly with all of the issues that we've identified today, but say there are opportunities to change those.
Stuart?
Yes, I would say the target needs to be looked at again, given the strength of the opportunity in the Highlands and Islands economy. We have around 8% of Scotland's population. I think in terms of housing, we need far more than 8% or 10% of the target that's here. So I would like to see that target increased.
But the kind of question there, if we increase the target, we've kind of been talking today. I mean, I guess the thing is that we very quickly need to be ironing out all the kind of wrinkles. Otherwise, we can increase the target by a certain date and we'll still not make it because...
Yeah, I mean, I think an increased target, but also an increased focus on delivery. That's right. What it's got to be about. I mean, targets should... My chairman sets and my board sets us stretching targets to try and get to. So we need to make sure that there's delivery to back up those numbers.
Certainly. Pauline?
It sounds to me like a review's needed. I think the demand's there, the need's there, and there's a desire to do it. And I think lots of communities have got plans in place and, you know, aspirations to do this. The problem is all the blockers that we've talked about today. So if they're removed, then, you know, you can increase targets, you can increase the numbers that we're going to do in the delivery. So, but yeah, it seems to need reviewed.
Thanks. Mike?
I mean, I think to get anywhere near these types of numbers, it obviously requires all the different pieces of the jigsaw to come together, of which community-led housing is just one part of the equation.
I think it's also important to remember that relative to communities leading on their own needs, driving targets by unit numbers is not always the best approach. And as we said before in this session, small numbers of new homes can have a big impact on communities. So, you know, bigger numbers is not always what specific rural communities need. They need the right houses in the right places. Having said that, there's loads of opportunity being driven by community-led housing, and I think the key to getting numbers up is partnership. So it's allowing communities to drive the agenda through place planning, to bring housing into community ownership, but also to catalyse other types of development and delivery by promoting partnership. And certainly we'd like to see the development agencies playing a role in helping enable that partnership, which I think there is already being done.
Russell?
Yeah, I think we need a different target, if I can put it that way, because it's not just about affordable homes, it's about all the homes we need. And it goes back to the point you've made several times, convener, about knowing what the demand is out there. So we need to know what we need to supply in all tenures, whether it's affordable houses, whether it's social housing, whether it's private housing, whether it's rented. So we probably need a different, in the rural areas, and that's why I think place planning is so, so important, is to get every community to look at where we are, and then we can better do it. So I think just focusing on one bit of it is the wrong answer, because that won't give us all what we want, which is places for people to stay across the whole gamut of housing.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Does anyone else have anything else we think we need to cover? I mean, I think there is, I'm kind of realising there's a whole other bit we could be talking about in terms of the challenges of retrofit, but probably not going to open that. I think it did get touched on a little bit, but, you know, just in terms of the shortage of supply of people with traditional building skills and that kind of thing. But anything else that you think really needs to be highlighted in this session today before we close? Yeah, Russell and then Elsa.
And we'll see what. And I hope Elsa might say the same thing. We place a lot of emphasis, quite rightly, today in communities. And I was with 12 communities last week, nothing to do with housing, that we're looking at. Did they want to buy a share in a wind farm? These are all volunteers. We are putting a huge burden on communities without really looking at the big issue here, which is how do we build capacity in those communities to deal with those issues, to have the people there to help them. And I think part of that, listen to the conversation a couple of weeks ago about you're getting volunteers from today committing their communities to 10, 15, 20 years ahead. And it's a difficult thing for a group of volunteers to do. So in all we do, not just around housing, we really need to start thinking about how we build capacity in the communities to do all the things, quite rightly, we think they should be involved in.
Okay, Elsa.
Thank you. I couldn't have put that better myself. I'm sure Pauline would agree with me. But I think the other point I'd like to make is that I made it at the start. Communities are stepping in because the private sector has failed and the public sector has failed. And the public sector has been funded to do this work for a very long time, and we're now seeing communities as a cheap solution. So I was a bit disappointed by the question about, you know, should we expect SOSH and Communities Housing Trust to be self-sustaining? Well, no, of course we shouldn't, because they are providing a public service, and we should be recognising they're providing a public service because they're addressing the issues that nobody else seems to be able to address. And I think we sometimes lose that. We think, oh, well, you know, nobody can do it, so let's let the communities deal with the derelict hotel, or let them deal with the housing issue, or let them deal with all these other issues. Well, yes, that's fine. They might be prepared to step up and do it, but we need to recognise it's a public service and they should be rewarded or funded accordingly, and not just assume it's always the cheap option.
And just in terms of the building capacity that Russell's brought up for communities, maybe you or Pauline have thoughts around, Pauline, what do we need to be doing in terms of building that capacity? Where do we need to start with that?
I mean, it's putting trust in the communities, I suppose, isn't it? You know, it's investment into them. And actually, you know, they do know what's best. I said it earlier, you know, about there has to be support mechanisms around communities to be able to let them do what they need to do. So there's investment in that infrastructure, that support mechanism for communities, not just expecting them to do it. I think there's more. We've talked about the funding, but we talk about investment a lot more these days. You know, like it's investment in a. These are complicated businesses, actually, you're setting up. They're not just running a lunch club or something like that. They're running buildings, pubs, schools, generally houses now. Do you know, like, these are complicated businesses and they need to be respected in the same way as other businesses are. So, yeah, I mean, I think that, we've got the answers there. We've got the blueprints there of how communities can do it. We've got, you know, endless stories of what they can do. But the job is not easy. And that, again, takes trust in, trust from Scottish Government in those community infrastructures and investment in those infrastructures. And I think sometimes, NSET's been talked about a couple of times, and I think there is some answers in some of the NSET sort of papers that I've seen or working groups that I've seen. Because it is about transformation of our country, and I do believe, again, I'll say, do you know what I said at the start with local governance review, I think there's extra governance reviews that need to go into local governance structures to give them the powers and the finances to do what they really, really need to do. And that's where I think, that's where it lies.
In terms of the support mechanisms that need to be wrapped around communities, who do you think should, where should that sit?
I think you've got evidence here, you know, Community Housing Trust Association, you've got another Rural Housing Trust and others out there who have got the expertise. We get calls on a daily basis about housing, and we're not experts in them. We're there in support of our members. We need people to be able to refer to them for the two houses in Cromarty or the 100 houses in Mull. You know, that we need other places to be able to get that expert help and support for that.
Do you think local authorities could play more of that kind of supporting role as well?
I think there's a possibility, but I mean, certainly we even came back with some of our members saying local authorities won't adopt roads when they've built the houses. So, you know, there's a lot more underlying there that needs to be sorted out between the local authority support, whether they might be keen to support, and that's what people have said here, but there's problems lying there where they don't want to take any extra burden, whereas the community's built the house, redone the roads, but they still won't adopt the roads to maintain it going forward. So there's some big issues there that need to be resolved.
Thanks. Anybody else want to come in with a final point? Stuart?
Just to say that, welcome the session today. I think housing has a huge role to play as an economic enabler. We think of it as something that's meeting the needs of communities, but it's actually fundamental to the economic growth and future of the Highlands and Islands in particular. If we're going to take advantage of the new job opportunities around renewables, we need housing to back that up. Last week I was at the opening of Stornoway Harbour, which is a £48 million investment. Western Isles has had a falling population, but that can be part of the rebirth of that economy if there's housing provided for the people and the people who are going to work in the renewable sector in the future. Thanks.
Okay. I think we're done there. I think that was a tremendous session. And again, we kind of started to highlight there at the end, there are some more things we could be touching on and kind of the role of private rented sector as well, retrofitting aspects and things like that. But thank you so much for joining us this morning. It's been really helpful to have this conversation, identify some of the areas where the Scottish Government could smooth the way. And I think the word blocks was used, remove the blocks. So very much appreciated that you came to join us and give us the evidence. And as we agreed at the start of the meeting, we're now going to take the next item in private.